not fucking crazy. I'm real. I'm fucking real. And that's what y'all don't like.
Because we were taught the blanket statement that violence is always wrong and that there's absolutely no nuance to it, when it comes to situations where there's violence, quote unquote, on both sides, what y'all will do is either look for the least violent of the two or for whoever's violence seems the most justifiable. But what y'all keep overlooking is the impact of power and propaganda and how that plays into your own pre-existing biases. And that's how I know y'all would not have walked with Martin Luther King. Y'all would not have sided with the poor during the French Revolution, and y'all would have been with the slave owners during slavery. Because of course the side with the money and the power and the resources can convince you anything that they want when it comes to the other side. Especially when they can afford to spend years, even decades, building up this other narrative about the other side so that when they do something violent, it seems horrific, it's barbaric, and it's exactly in line with who you think that they are. And of course, those with the resources can paint themselves as a more perfect victim. And we saw that happen in real time, because as soon as we saw the Israeli government say that Hamas had beheaded 40 babies, even though that statement was unsubstantiated, that rumor went everywhere. Everyone believed it. And that's because we have spent years, even decades, being indoctrinated to think that Palestinians, and more generally, Arabs and Muslims, are these barbaric, awful, savage people. So yeah, it seems like it's not even a stretch that would happen, and it's just justified in your heads. And flip side of the same coin, the Israeli government and the Western government has convinced many of us that, like, Israel could do no wrong. And because they have the money and resources to create successful propaganda, people are using this as justification for the ethnic cleansing of the Palestinian people. Even though that claim is not true. And people fell for it like that. So y'all are not gonna tell me that in the face of like actual confirmed horrific violence, like what took place during the slave rebellions and the French Revolution, y'all are siding with the oppressed. Because you're not. Y'all lack the tools to understand that violence can beget violence, and that sometimes that is a tool of the oppressed to get away from the violence of the oppressor. And that, coupled with how quickly y'all fall for propaganda, y'all weren't siding with us. Y'all was not walking with us.
What do y'all think revolution resistance is? Like, I really want to ask y'all, what do you think that entails? You think it's cute? Do you think it's just posting squares online? I'm trying to talk about how marginalized people, when they're dealing with violent oppression, the response is typically going to be violent back because they're going to mirror the tactics of the oppressor. And I'm using enslaved Black people as an example. And someone's like, oh, well, does that include unaliving children and doing this to women? What do you think? What do you think? Atrocities absolutely happen to the innocence of the oppressors. And one could even argue whether you can call them innocent. If you care about the innocence of the oppressors, then they shouldn't be oppressors. It's the oppressor's fault. That's what some of y'all are not getting, right? If atrocities happen to innocent people that happen to be a part of a group that is oppressing or a part of a state that is oppressing, it's the oppressor's fault. Because where did the violence stem from, right? If people are responding to violence, if they're responding to violence by creating more violence, doing atrocities, what do you think is happening to the marginalized people? Hello? Being enslaved, being raped, being sexually assaulted, being murdered, being taken as prisoners of war, dealing with genocide. All of that is going to cause a violent reaction. And you might call it an extreme or extremist reaction, right? Because those are really fucking extreme conditions. If we're gonna sit here and call marginalized people or groups of marginalized people extremists, hate groups, and maybe even, yes, terrorists, when they are simply mirroring the tactics and actions that is happening to them, being imposed onto them by an oppressor group, what does that make that oppressor group? Who created the reality? Who created the violent reality? If we're gonna condemn violence in all forms, then we have to start with the source of the violence, because they're creating that environment. Otherwise, it looks like you just want to accept violence coming from certain people, certain states, certain groups, and not other ones that are responding to that. And not for nothing, you care so much about the innocence of the oppressor state or the oppressor group. Do you care about what's happening to the marginalized group? Because the same shit's happening to the same shit happens to the marginalized group. That it doesn't just come out of nowhere. What do y'all think revolution and resistance is? Like, I really want to ask y'all, what do you think that entails? You think it's cute?
350,000 people. That's how many Haitians are said to have died during the Haitian Revolution. 350,000.
If you want to understand why I, as a Black person, have complete solidarity and stand with Palestinians. It's because I recognize that what is happening right now is comparable to the Haitian Revolution, the Battle of Algiers.
When I was studying Black spirituality in seminary, the Haitian Revolution came up often because it was a spiritual gathering that initiated this resistance to colonizers. Resistance to the colonial power opposing them, the French, cost Haiti about 350,000 lives. On the other hand, it's estimated that 75,000 white French people died. And at the end of the revolution, Haiti becomes the first independent Black republic on the planet. I want to be very clear, I don't mean to conflate these two historical events. They're distinct and separated by time, place, and context. I get that. And this is what resistance to colonial power costs in real life. Lives. We talk about historical events like the Haitian Revolution, and we celebrate the end result, which is them becoming a free Black republic. But I don't hear many people talk about the cost, because the cost is ugly, it's deadly, it's gruesome. It is the thing we've been trained to either turn our heads away from or condemn. So I really think as much as we need to decolonize our minds around the narratives presented to us on this topic, we should also decolonize our understanding of violence, especially as it relates to liberation. Check out this video.
What do you think that a Black person today can learn from the Haitian Revolution?
I think the revolution shows us this idea of nonviolence that we are fed by the state in the U.S. Mm-hmm. When we are fed this idea of nonviolence, when you look at the past, how the hell can you gain liberation in a violent state without meeting violence with some other type of violence?
What this society does is it makes you uncomfortable with these types of, even these types of conversations.
Yes.
It's undeniable that we live in a violent society that, it, you know, whose rules are held in place by a system that will at any moment enact violence against those who defy its laws. And anytime there is conversations like this around around violence and around like meeting that violence with violence and around like how, why that historically has happened with examples like the Haitian Revolution, with Nat Turner, et cetera.
Yes.
Even me listening to this conversation, you shedding light on that, there's a seed of like discomfort in there that I'm still working through, I guess. But it's important that we have these conversations and really shed light and be honest about the kind of society that we live in and the means that people have had to use historically to get freedom and to experience humanity. And sometimes it costs people their very lives.
But I think that's important. What you just modeled, Donnell, is that you realize that even as we're talking, and you know, then it's not about agreeing or disagreeing, there's an uncomfortability, mm-hmm. right, in the information. The fact that you can actually signal it, call it, allows you to work with it. So when you have that uncomfortability, it allows you to the conversation. Because my question back to you is, who taught you that?
Mm-hmm.
It's true. And I always tell folks, ask yourself, who taught you these things and is it actually true?
Oh, because, wow.
Right? So there's a way that what you are doing is you are breaking the hold of the illusion that society told you was reality in order to have the reality of you enter into the conversation and knock that door open. So to be uncomfortable in this idea of nonviolence, I ask everybody, who taught you what nonviolence is? And those who taught you, do they actually exercise nonviolence themselves?
Thank you for watching, and as always, like and follow for more content.
No, it was no 15 minutes ago, and it's no now. Like, every time, I understand.
We are not at war. This is a genocide. A U.S.-backed Israeli genocide against the Palestinians living in Gaza. Over 2 million people under bombardment. No food, no water, no shelter, no electricity, no gas. They were told to evacuate and then bombed on their way out. There is nowhere for them to go. This is not the solution. The solution is stop the bombing. Restore basic human needs. If you stand with Israel, you either need to educate yourself further or you are a terrible human being. That's it. That's the message.
So recently, the U.S. Treasury Secretary said that we could absolutely afford another war. And people were shocked by her saying this because we can't afford things like free healthcare or relieving student loan debt or doing anything about the housing crisis or inflation or, you know, anything. And I don't know why we're shocked. Putting aside the fact that the U.S. government generally doesn't give two flying flips about the people who live in the United States, it's pretty obvious that we can afford another war on top of the one we're already supporting in Ukraine, because this isn't a war. One side has no army, no navy, no real military. They have radical groups, they have liberation movements, but they don't have soldiers to go send into war. The war is with the civilians. Conversely, the other side is so strapped that they had an iron dome that we all thought was impenetrable. In fact, when news first broke out that Hamas had attacked Israel, everyone was surprised. Do you know how much it is not a war if we are all shocked that the other side of the war got a hit in and then proceeds to not really get in another one? This isn't a war. These are civilians, largely 18 and younger, versus a government that has been backed by the entire globe, namely the US superpower for decades. Of course we can fund Israel. Of course we can support another war. There's no real other side. This is not a war. This is colonialism and conquest at best. At this point, it's a genocide. And one thing about the United States is that if a cause serves us enough, we will always have the money and resources to fund it.
Jesus Christ. I don't even know how to, nigga, what?
Both Black people and Palestinians have had the unique, horrific experience of the entire world turning you into a monster because you won't go quietly into your own genocide. You guys keep asking, Alexia, do you support Palestine? Obviously, I support a free Palestine. I stand in solidarity with every oppressed person, but particularly Palestinians, because I see the Black experience in them. People keep saying what's happening to them is inhumane, they're war crimes, and what I uniquely understand as a Black American is that what is done to them will never be considered a war crime because they're not seen as human, because your humanity isn't based on the fact that we have the same organs and the same blood flowing through our veins, but how profitable you are to the colonial empires that seek to exploit you. And as long as you can be exploited, you're no longer human. You're just a resource. Even today in 2023, when we have achieved ostensible freedom and we're no longer on plantations, Black people are not really free because we continue to be a resource exploited by the United States government, because this government never came up with an economic plan outside of slavery. And so racism is the justification, so they don't have to feel bad about what they're doing to human beings. I know the pain of what it's like to watch people hang string lights up in the trees where your ancestors, not your distant ancestors, but like your uncles, your aunts, your grandparents were lynched, and then have parties or fucking weddings on the grounds, on the land that was soaked in your blood, where your ancestors were tortured and raped and maimed. I'm very good with words normally, but it's hard for me to emphasize what a mindfuck it is to know that fundamentally, I never did anything wrong, my family never did anything wrong, we as a collective never did anything wrong, except for exist in a way that's inconvenient to colonial powers. And now my ancestors and my family and I and my children seem to be in this cycle of suffering that's impossible to get out of. And so when I watch that happen to groups across oceans, even though I have never met a Palestinian person in my life, how can I not empathize and see myself in that struggle? I'm very comfortable standing in an opinion held by Malcolm X and Angela Davis and others, the people that I look up to the most. I'm not naive, and I don't think that a random TikTok creator is going to change the sphere of the global movement that's happening right now. But what I want to use my platform to say is that the way that people are attempting to honor Palestinians or talk about Palestinian liberation is disrespectful. And because I just spent the last 2 minutes talking about how I, a Black American woman who descended from the enslaved on this land, see myself in the Palestinian struggle for liberation, I want to say that the way that so many people have attempted to talk about a free Palestine is disrespectful and insulting. Making a cutesy infographic to talk about the genocide of a people is horrendous. It's horrific. I can't tell you how upsetting it was in the midst of the Black Lives Matter movement, when everyone was feigning an interest in what's been happening to us for the past 400 years, to watch people turn Breonna Taylor into a meme or put stars, or the fact that someone sat down in a Canva and thought about making the death of Black people at the hands of the police state colorful. You owe the people you claim to advocate for respect and dignity in what may be their final moments. At the time of posting this, people in Gaza no longer have access to internet, electricity, gas, water. They owe, you owe them more than a fucking, well, this is like the Biggie and Tupac version of, you know, I saw someone on Twitter say, they are people and they are dying. And if you're not serious in your advocacy, if this is not something that you are approaching with heart and empathy and a reverence for the war crimes being committed, then close your mouth. I think people are using this as an opportunity to slam dunk, you know, acquaintances from high school. There is a respect you ought to have. And I think it's missing. And that upsets me and it disturbs me. Because it is another type of pain to know that you are being dehumanized, and even the people who are attempting to humanize you still don't recognize the humanity in your pain.
Not so hot take. Violence from the oppressed against the oppressor is always, and I mean always, the fault of the oppressor. Second, please stop calling it the Israel and Palestine conflict. It is not a conflict. Conflict implies that both sides have similar or equal powers, which they don't. It's a massacre. Call it what it is. Three, yes, Jewish people deserve a place to exist without fear. However, it should not come at the expense of the lives of millions of people on their indigenous land. What? Four, harassing Jewish creators does nothing to help Palestine. Leave them alone. They don't need your anti-Semitism. And five, clock me if this is anti-Semitism, but how exactly is this different from the oppression you are trying to escape? It's giving Hitler right now. For real.
أنا دم فلسطيني
We have no idea where they went.
Oh, we have no idea? Just like we want to have a weekend in Santa Fe? You have no idea. You want to go to Santa Fe.
So I knew they would try to silence me, but yeah. If they ban my account, I need you guys to speak up. I need you to be louder than thunder for Palestine. I need you to let them know that they cannot silence us because we are their voices right now. But at least you guys know I was speaking truth. Go ahead and follow my backup account just in case. Because if they ban my account, I will keep talking about Palestine. Even if I have to make 10 accounts, I'm not gonna stop because I can't sit by and just watch a genocide happen. I can't.
Free Palestine till it's backwards. And that's all I gotta say about that.
Many men wish death upon me. Blood in my dog and I can't see. I'm trying to be what I'm destined.
If you're an ally to the Palestinian cause these past 2 weeks, you've done a fantastic job of sharing, protesting, calling your reps, making your voice heard. But we can take it a step further by boycotting Israeli products or products that help aid Israel in the oppression of Palestine. For example, boycotting HP because they provide the tech for biometric ID, which Israel uses to restrict Palestinian movement. I found this app yesterday called Boycott, which makes the process really easy. We know our actual votes mean nothing when we're voting between one war criminal and another, so we have to vote with our dollar. And there are a ton of companies on this list. You'll see 65 here, and it's difficult to remember them all, so this app allows you to follow a campaign, in this case, the Long Live Palestine Boycott Israel campaign. And if you scan a product, it'll automatically tell you if it's on the list or not. To be honest, I don't know if this campaign is being actively maintained on the app, but I did cross-check the companies with the current BDS targets, and they're all there. This form of protest is so powerful. Like, being vegan, I've seen and been part of the impact on the dairy industry and the rise of vegan products. I mean, if this type of protest didn't work, then the BDS movement, which for context is a Palestinian-led peaceful movement to boycott, divest, and sanction Israel, basically apply pressure on Israel to comply with humanitarian law, wouldn't be illegal in 35 states. Which, isn't that wild? It blows my mind in a country so obsessed with free speech that a form of peaceful protest is illegal. Seems unconstitutional, but okay. Anyway, I send you so much love if you're out here trying to be on the right side of history. Every single Arab appreciates it so much.
Israel has the right to defend itself. Wow, that's totally not an overused statement. Let's do some critical thinking, okay? Let's use our critical thinking skills like we used to do in high school when we solved those questions in the textbook. Okay, so who are they defending themselves from? Who? I want to hear your answer. Hamas, great. So then why are most of the deaths children? Palestinian children. The justification that the Israeli Defense Forces are using to bomb Gaza this much, which by the way is preceding historical figures, is because they claim that Hamas is in Gaza somewhere, except they're targeting bustling towns and homes and landmarks that have a 100% guarantee rate that there's children inside there. They're doing this knowing fully well they're just killing civilians and there's no Hamas in sight. When a Palestinian child dies, it's an Arab child. You know, just at the wrong place at the wrong time. Which are about 1,000 plus. But when an Israeli child dies, everyone stop, I stand with Israel. You guys are so dehumanizing.
What do you mean we? Nintendo?
No,
we?
Nigga, we as in us. Us. Are you talking about
no,
the movie?
Nigga, us.
Global black solidarity for Palestine, without discussing black Palestinians or Afro-Palestinians themselves. Some Afro-Palestinians trace their roots to the land as far back as the 12th century, and are descendants of Muslim pilgrims who went to Mecca for Hajj and then settled in Jerusalem. Others are the descendants of those who migrated from places such as Nigeria, Sudan, Senegal, and Chad. Some of them came to Palestine specifically to fight against British colonialism and Zionism.
The second, third, fourth generation, if you ask us to identify ourselves, we say we are Afro-Palestinians. We born here, we grew up here.
The community is deeply rooted in Jerusalem, with a long history of involvement in the Palestinian Liberation Movement. Ali Jidda is a leader of Jerusalem's Afro-Palestinian community, who served 17 years in Israeli prisons as a member of the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine.
Let's talk about an Afro-Palestinian that was part of the Marxist-Leninist revolutionary group in Palestine, the PLFP. This is Ali Jidda. He was in prison for 17 years. He was a major part of the resistance against the Israeli occupation. He, like many other Afro-Palestinians, have talked about the struggle of being doubly subjugated, doubly oppressed, because of being black and Palestinian.
Look on us. In a way, so discriminated, so racist, they call us Kushi.
No!
This way, brother.
You see? One of the words they just mentioned, Kushi. Where they began calling us niggers, Sambo. Niggers, Sambo.
Was that the kids?
Yeah, the kids. They began saying Kushi.
Harriet Tubman was walking around with a fucking nice shiny fucking dress on with a fucking crown on her head when she was taking slaves to freedom.